Today is January 10th, 2020. My name is En Shi. I'm with the Houston Asian American Archive. Today we have Mr. Washington Binh Ho to join us for this oral history interview about his life. Thank you so much, Mr. Ho.
Hi, Anne. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good.
Thank you so much for having me. Yes, thank you for having me.
Thank you. To start, can you tell us when and where were you born?
I was born in Houston, Texas, 1981. My birthday is August 15th. I'm a Leo. The year of the rooster.
Great, amazing. Can you describe the neighborhood you grew up in?
Yes, I grew up in the north side of Houston, Inwood. I grew up near Acres Homes. I grew up in a lower income area. My parents came here from Vietnam. And so when I was growing up, we lived in a 1700 square foot home. And that's where I grew up.
Amazing. And can you tell us a little bit about the demographics in that neighborhood?
The demographics when I was growing up, I believe, were a little bit different than what we have today. Today with, they built 45 in Little York and it connected to Antoine. So, it was a very diverse neighborhood. I went to public school up to the age of 11. And, we have our African-Americans, we have our Hispanics, we have lots of Caucasian when I was growing up. But today you see mostly minorities and, a lot of the Caucasians have left.
Thank you. Can you also share with us some of your childhood memories? Like who are your childhood friends and what were some of the games you played together and what kind of childhood food that you remember having?
Sure. Growing up, kickball was one of my favorite sports. I have an older sister, Judy, who is now an attorney, and a younger brother, Reagan. And so my parents worked a lot. And, what we did was we played around the neighborhood and kickball was one of our favorite sports. We played tennis with each other. We, played football in the streets. And, some of my favorite foods growing up is what my mom cooked. I love Vietnamese food. And one of my favorite dishes from my mom was a pork belly and egg, very comfort food. And we love it for Chinese Lunar New Year too.
Yeah, that was amazing. Growing up with Vietnamese food, did you learn a few recipes?
Sure. I learned a lot of recipes for Vietnamese food. When we were growing up, if my mom was out working, we would have to learn how to cook for ourselves. And also when I went off to college, I missed my mom's food. It gave me comfort. And so, I would call my mom and say, how do you, cook the pork belly and eggs? How do you, cook, the fish soup? How do you cook? And so, I cook a lot of Vietnamese food and I really enjoy it.
That's great. And moving on, can you share with us some of the stories that your parents told you about their immigrant experiences back then?
Sure. My father, who was in the Vietnam War, he actually came to America in 1968 and 1971 to train in the Air Force. And, my mother, she grew up in Long Xuyen, Vietnam, which is about 3 hours from the capital, Ho Chi Minh City today, but it was Saigon back then, where my father was from. And, on their journey to America, my father didn't get to leave right away because he had to go get my mother. And so that was 3 days after the war. They got rescued by a ship and the ship went to Singapore. From Singapore, they went to the Philippines and they stayed in the refugee camp over there until America could sponsor them to America. Once they got to America, they went to Fort Chaffee, Arkansas, where a lot of Vietnamese refugees lived. And I think about 6 months later, they got sponsored to Kerrville, Texas. And that was our first time in Texas. My father's first job was pumping gas at the Exxon there in Kerrville. And my mother, she learned English at Shriner College. And so that was their journey. And they, you know, it was a tough time for them, but my father was very grateful that he was going to end up in a country where any one of his dreams could come true, he felt, because he was in the land of opportunity. And that was his attitude when he came to America.
Did they share any part of their American dream story, like their perspective back then, how they wanted their life to be in America?
Yeah, you know, for my mom, she came from a small town in Vietnam. So her idea was, you know, if she had food and water and a home, she'd be fine. For my father, who came from a family of successful business entrepreneurs, he had a big dream. And he knew that if he came to America, anything he accomplished would be credited to him. And so when he came here, he also had 10 brothers and sisters. He had his two parents. He was the oldest son. He had three cousins and my mom to feed. And so he didn't really have a choice to have any small dreams. He had to figure out how to feed 14 people. And so as he was pumping gas, he learned the business. And my mom, learning English, she helped him grow the business. And they moved to Houston, Texas in 1977. They moved here because my grandmother loved the climate. She thought it was very similar to Vietnam. My father could, you know, look for a real job. And, you know, he started selling life insurance for a company called Washington National Life Insurance. And that's where he envisioned to name his son Washington. And my mother, she started working for U-Totem, which owned Circle K. She started off sweeping floors and she became the supervisor. Once she became the supervisor, my father called his brothers and sisters and got them to start working there. So my mom trained all of her family. Once they trained the family, there was a real estate crash in 1981, I believe. And my father and mother bought their first convenience store in the Fifth Ward. And, you know, Grocery Supply financed the inventory. And about 5 years later, they bought, sold, and developed almost 100 of them. And so that's where the real estate career began for my family as well. So my father's dream was to open a bank. He felt like there was a lot of Vietnamese refugees who weren't as educated as him, and he wanted to share the knowledge of the American financial system. And so, you know, once he created the bank, he felt like that was his legacy, to help other Vietnamese or minorities learn about finance, learn how to borrow money so that they could build and scale their businesses. And my mom, she was the controller, the CFO of the company. You know, she paid attention to the money. She paid attention to human resources. And myself, since the age of four, about 4 years old, where I learned a lot of math, was that we had to count, you know, food stamps, we had to count money, we had to count coupons. And so we learned about supply chain at a very young age. And, you know, we helped out where we could, and my parents were focused on, you know, building their legacy.
That's amazing to hear that your parents, like, that history of really devoting themselves to building the dream for the family. And I'm wondering, what kind of family values or qualities do you see that you kind of got passed on from your parents?
Well, my parents are, they've always put, you know, their faith, number one, and their family, number two. And what I see from my father's leadership, him being the big brother, he always made sure that his family was taken care of, not just with food and water, but to put his family in the best position to succeed. Before he invested in any businesses, he always wanted to invest in his family first. And that means time. And my mom, you know, with her proud Asian culture and heritage, she was actually the oldest daughter in her family. So she has 8 brothers and sisters. And so she's very used to taking care of a lot of siblings. And I feel like my parents, you know, wanted their kids to be proud, and they wanted their kids to always think about legacy. So my sister, Judy's the name of the lady that taught my mother English when she came from Vietnam. And so that's why they named her Judy. She was the first. And then my name, Washington, is because, you know, Washington is, you know, the greatest leader in America. And my father always wanted to remind me that in America, just because you're Asian doesn't mean you can't be the president of America. You're born here, your name's Washington, and that's why I named you that. My younger brother, who's 2 years younger, was named after Ronald Reagan. My father loved country Western movies. My brother was born in 1983, and Reagan was a president at the time. And my dad, you know, is a guy that has big vision, and he thinks about legacy. And so your name is everything. And he wanted us to be grateful and be proud that we're in a country where anything's possible. And my mom, you know, she was more of the disciplinarian. I think my dad was more of the friendly type. He's your best friend. You can confide in him. We like to, you know, hunt and fish. But one thing that I respected a lot about my parents is that they always put time first. They never put money first. They understood that businesses would always go up and down, and there was always going to be, you know, issues or problems with business. But to them, it was better to hire someone to deal with that and hang out with their kids after school or on the weekends than to go in there and try to save as many nickels as possible. And so I believe that really made, you know, myself and my sister and my brother very proud to have parents like that.
Yeah, that's really heartwarming to hear that your family are so caretaking and so loving for each other. I'm just also wondering, how are your relationship with your brother and sister? Yeah, one brother, one sister.
Our relationships, you know, they have their ups and downs, but, you know, we always love each other just as much as we did when we were kids. I look up to my sister. She is Jihai. She's the oldest daughter. She tutored, you know, me and my brother when we were younger. She helped us with our homework. My younger brother, you know, we love each other in a different way. We're very competitive. We like to hunt and fish together. And, you know, we're best friends. We play golf together. We live in America, but we always celebrate our Asian culture. So we all live, you know, within a mile of each other. And we're very proud of that.
Thank you. And I'm also wondering, given your parents came from humble beginnings when they first moved here, and did you kind of witness that kind of change in their wealth level impacted your lifestyle growing up?
It definitely did. I mean, when we were growing up, you know, going from, you know, this is our third home. I'm in my parents' home today. Very proud to live in this great neighborhood here in River Oaks. But growing up, you know, we really didn't know the difference. You know, all we knew was that people would come up to my father And, you know, people would always basically worship him or something, but I didn't know why. I didn't know what he did that was so great. To me, it was just my dad. And we started going to private school when I was 11 years old, and that was a culture shock. So, you know, one day I'm going to school with, you know, this, you know, as that area started getting, you know, Little York got built, and then it's just like everybody was moving into that area. There was all different types of people. And then one day I go to private school and I'm the only, I'm like the only minority in there. And it was very, very awkward. My father didn't prepare me for that. I didn't know that I had been interviewing for private school, you know, for a few years before that. But it was definitely a rude awakening. It was a culture shock. You know, suddenly my friend from my neighborhood kind of started separating away from us because they thought we were different now because I was in a private school. But the kids at private school, they had probably never seen an Asian at that time or many minorities that, you know, and so it was hard to build friendships. It was a lonely time, but I had my sister who was my best friend. And over time, I think the world changed, and I'm still friends with some kids from school today, but it definitely changed a lot of things. I think that's one reason why Judy, myself, and Reagan are so close. It's because we all have that experience.
Did you all go to the same private school?
Yes, we did. We all went to Second Baptist, you know, which was, you know, it was a good school. You know, I went there, but for my senior year, I left to go to Lutheran North, another private school. My sister graduated from Second Baptist, and Lutheran North was, you know, it was a different environment. It was a private school, but it was a lot more culturally diverse, I would say. I was a lot more comfortable there. And my brother went to Second Baptist as well.
Thank you for sharing. I'm wondering if you are willing to share some of the, like, probably the stereotypes that kids were put into back then in school.
Well, at the time, you know, it was the stereotypes of being Asian and coming from my neighborhood was that, the kids at school would, you know, this is hard to say on the record, but I guess, you know, they would assume that, you know, if you wore baggy pants, you were gang related. You know, if you had tigers, you were gang related. You know, it's tough when, you know, the other kids are growing up in the school and the parents are involved, and, you know, you're expected to do maybe, you know, when you have to get closer to the top as an Asian person in that type of environment is very tough. But, you know, I always celebrated my difference. I always felt like, you know, I was grateful that I was different because it set me apart. I ran for student president my eighth grade year at Second Baptist. My dad was proud of me. My sister thought I was crazy. She was like, you don't even have any friends here. And I said, well, you know, like, I'm going to try anyway. And I campaigned, and I remember my sister helped me write my speech. And it was pretty funny. The first thing, the first line was, I remember Judy wrote it. It was, hi, my name is Washington. Please vote for me. I'm named after the greatest president in America, and I'm going to do the same job for you. And, you know, I lost the election, but what that did for me was it created a network. And I feel like a lot of times we as Asian people, we live in America, we need to remember that, you know, it's up to us to go and introduce ourselves. I always use an example as if I was living in Vietnam and an American or white person moved to my neighborhood, well, I'm going to be like, I might look at my neighbor and be like, oh, who's that? But like, I'm not gonna go over there and introduce myself. And another thing I did to assimilate into the culture and break down the stereotype was I played football. I played football for the school and I loved the challenge. And my dad, he really loved for me to play football because he feels like it's a great representative of life. When you get knocked down, you gotta get back up. But once I started playing football, I started making a lot more friends in my school. And so what that taught me was, you know, if you can come up and, you know, shake someone's hand and introduce yourself, then you're giving them the opportunity to get to know you. And that's how, you know, I felt. I felt like, you know, I could lead. And if I lead, then other Asian people would understand what to do. Another thing I did to help myself not be as shy and uncomfortable in that environment was I started working at an ice cream shop down the street. So my parents, since they worked a lot back then, after football practice, I would walk from school, Second Baptist, to this ice cream coffee shop because I saw that, you know, there's a busboy, you get to wear a white shirt, you get to wear a tie. And I saw a lot of beautiful American girls. And at the time I was like, I'm gonna learn how to talk to people. So I started working there and that opened up my mind as well. And so from that point on, I never got uncomfortable again of being Asian in America. I felt like, you know, we're all human beings at the end of the day. It's just up to us to communicate effectively. And, you know, I'm always proud of being Vietnamese American. And I feel like, you know, there's a lot of Asian people that might be a little timid. And I hope that, you know, this project that I work on always, you know, open up people's eyes and inspire people. That's what I always wanted to do.
Wow, that's really inspiring to share that for you to share with us. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thank you. And just wondering how important is Vietnamese heritage in your childhood from, I guess, in your family background? You mentioned that you have a lot of, like, how and also how, like, your Vietnamese middle name, like, do you kind of have a Vietnamese name as well as the English Washington name?
Yes, my middle name is Bin, like my father, B-I-N-H. I'm Washington Binh Ho Jr. And my son is Roosevelt Binh Ho, you know, the second. And so we've followed that example. And, you know, for me, I speak Vietnamese. I grew up reading and writing Vietnamese. You know, Vietnamese was our first language. We didn't speak anything else. I actually had to take ESL in elementary school for up until like fourth grade, I believe. My sister, she picked it up quicker, but for my kids, you know, we have a Vietnamese nanny and we speak a little Vietnamese to him, but you know, to continue Vietnamese culture and tradition, it is important, but I think the world has evolved as well. I feel like there's great things about Eastern culture, but also living in Western society, I see some things that I think they do better. But the one thing that, you know, I think that is really super important in the Vietnamese culture is family. Over here, sometimes I see my American friends, you know, they're like, man, I wish my I wish my parents loved me that much. Does your parents really like call you all the time and your friends? I'm like, yeah, they do. And it's great. And there's pluses and minuses, but I think they're really checking up on me. And so, you know, I feel like in the Asian culture, we're a lot more, we respect our parents and our ancestors in a very, it's very important to us. And I'll always continue to do that. And that's really important to me.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And I'm also wondering with the kind of heritage side, I remember seeing in the House of Ho, your TV series, like the family would wear the traditional Vietnamese áo dài. And like would you expect your children and your grandchildren to be carrying on family heritage or cultural heritage, from costume to like language to like any other cultural traits, to carry on that part of the heritage?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, the Lunar New Year is a very big tradition and holiday for our culture. And I would hope that, you know, the show made it pretty cool to be Asian is what I kind of wanted. And, you know, for my daughter to wear áo dài and my niece is to wear áo dài, I think it's beautiful. I think, you know, after the show, hearing from the fans is that they thought the dresses were beautiful. They sent messages of where can I get that? And, you know, it was amazing that we've, you know, grown up all of our lives celebrating the dragon dancing and the culture. And for my neighbors who are well traveled around the world, it was the first time they've ever seen that. They've never even seen that on TV or in movies or anything. And you know, these are well-educated people. So I was very proud to show the world in my neighborhood that, you know, our culture is beautiful. I feel like sometimes in our culture, we're trained to be quiet and be timid and keep to ourselves and, you know, just study without the social aspects of life until you get ready to marry. But how can you, you know, create a partnership, a life partnership with someone if you don't learn how to socialize at a young age? And one of my goals to do the show was to open up people's eyes and make it cool to be yourself. I feel like the expectations put upon the Asian people from society today is that we're supposed to be the model minority. But I feel like there's a glass ceiling into every type of dreams that we have over here. And for me, I wanted to shatter that glass ceiling. And that's why I did the show, so that we remember that anything's possible. You know, it was time. I think it was the right time to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess going back to a little bit about your school experience, what were some of your favorite subjects at school?
What? My favorite subject of school, I was good at math. I won a few math competitions at a young age. I enjoyed philosophy. Philosophy was great. I loved, you know, everything that it helped me to think, it helped me to analyze, it helped me to have logic. But I think the best school in the world is experience. I think the books where I went to school at SMU or the books at Harvard, you know, they all teach the same thing. But of course, you know, there's a different network at different schools, but you have to know how to use that. And being Asian, you know, I feel like sometimes we're always trained to go read the book back and forth and get 100 on our grade. But the time that we should be using to socialize, we don't take advantage of that. I was more of a social person, as you can tell. I enjoyed meeting people. I enjoyed going to the gym. I enjoyed going, you know, to the student association meetings and you know, building Asian people's confidence. That's where I enjoyed it. But my favorite subject, I would have to say, I don't think partying is a subject, right? I mean, I don't think I had a favorite subject. I had favorite teachers, but I was more of a social person. That's what I enjoy the classes with the pretty girls. I'll say that. I'm a little bit different.
That's cool to hear. Thank you. And I'm also wondering, given kind of your family background being very wealthy and you kind of going to starting your first job as a waiter and a busboy at the coffee shop and ice cream, were your kind of family, what did your family say about starting at like humble jobs like that?
You know, my father was very proud. When I came home and I said, Dad, I got a job. And he was like, what are you talking about? I was like, look, I made $12 today. It was like, I counted all the nickels and dimes. So every time people's money would fall out, I would be like so happy, you know, because I have to sweep the floors. I'm like, oh, there's a nickel, there's a penny. But after 3 months, my mom came to pick me up one time and she saw how hard I was working. I had to stack the chairs. And, you know, I was only 14 years old. And I remember, you know, she was like, why are you doing this? You know, you need to study school. You need to focus more on school. You don't need to do this. This is not what you're going to do for the rest of your life. And my dad told my mom, like, don't say that to him. You know, I remember this. But my mom was proud that I was working. But I think, you know, she was more concerned about my safety. And I think that's an Asian thing. Sometimes we shelter our kids. And you know, my mom, you know, she came from a different town in Vietnam, but my father came from a big city. And, you know, he would always tell my mom, don't worry, we're in America, you know, it'll be fine. But overall, my parents were pretty happy that I was working at the time.
Yeah, that's great to hear. Could you tell us a little bit about your college experience at the Southern Methodist University? Like, what clubs were you part of? What subject did you study?
Well, that, you know, going to college was an experience for me. I went to SMU. I was very proud. My major was real estate and finance. I was on a scholarship for academics, I remember, and I made the dean's list my first year. But at the time, all my life, I had always wanted to be an entrepreneur. So at that time in 1999, the technology boom was happening, and I took my monthly allowance for 2 months and opened a trading account with Ameritrade. And I also started a club promotion business at the time. So I was always looking at ways to make money while going to school. And I think after my first year of doing business, I made a very good amount of money. I was living large, as they say. And I called my dad and I was like, hey dad, you know, why do I need to go to school? I said, you know, the average salary right now for someone graduating here, you know, I think it was 45 grand at the time. I said, I can make that in a week. I mean, this is, you know, I think I need to focus on that. And my dad was like, no, you don't understand, son. You know, you need to study school. I'm proud of you for doing business. But during that time, I was in the Vietnamese Student Association. I, you know, was in the business club. I, you know, was studying real estate to get my license as well. I invested in some restaurants. Some are closed, but there's one that's still open, Crew Wine Bar. There's one in down the street from me here in River Oaks and one in the Woodlands. And I made a lot of friends at the time, but I feel like, again, it was tough going to a Southern private school college. I was, again, you know, it wasn't a very diverse school. It was hard to make friends. I didn't want to join the fraternity. I felt like if I joined the fraternity, I would have to try to be someone I'm not. And to me, I don't enjoy that. But SMU was a great experience. I made great friends, especially the ones that were from Houston, and we're still friends to this day. A lot of my friends from SMU are very successful. They come from a lot of diverse backgrounds, but some of the best friends I made there were kids that were from Vietnam that, you know, really needed my help. And what I would do is I would help them write their English papers, and they would help me with like my chemistry homework or like my calculus three stuff where, and physics where it would go over my head, but it was so easy for them. But for their English, it was hard for them to be articulate. So it was like a trade. They would help me with physics and all that stuff, and I would help them with their English paper. And I had a great time in college.
That's amazing to hear. And so the friends, were they from Vietnam?
Yes, I had a friend from Vietnam. I actually, you know, one of them had me invest in their companies. We had an office in Ho Chi Minh City in 2008. He was in the engineering school. So we used to export oil and gas machinery and parts to Asia, and we did really well. But I couldn't be as involved after, you know, 5 years. And for me, it was taking a toll traveling there, entertaining clients in Asia is a whole nother story. It's very tiring. And so I sold out my position. But I do have some Caucasian friends, a few, that I still keep in contact with.
I guess next, I'm very curious about how you develop your entrepreneurial sense. Like, did your father kind of had this lecture or private tuition with you to develop that?
No, he didn't. I just grew up. Since everybody idolized my father, it naturally happened to me that I wanted to be just like him. And, you know, he would always tell me as a young child that in the Asian culture, you know, if you want to be rich, the only way is to do business. So all my life, I just thought business, business, business. And I got inspired by, you know, a lot of the people that were around my father that I thought were cool, you know, other business people. I thought I liked their lifestyle. I liked that, you know, you can create a business which can create an avenue for other people to have great lives, but also create time for you and your family. And that's what I loved about it the most. But once I started owning my own business, it was a whole nother story. You know, it wasn't what I thought it would be. It was you know, there's ups and downs to it. When I got into business, I feel like I didn't get into it for the right reasons. I thought I just wanted to be rich and have money. And that can only take you so far. And, you know, I had a lot of hard lessons in my life that a lot of people don't see. My father's a military guy. He's not the kind of guy that's gonna bail you out. Now, if you listen to him, it's a different story, but you know, I always felt like I could do things bigger and better. So anything my family wasn't involved in, like energy, I got into. I was in healthcare for a little bit. My family wasn't in that. And then now I'm into, you know, the Hollywood business, which my family didn't really, only my dad supported me in the beginning. he liked my vision, he liked my potential. My mom, she thought I was crazy, but she didn't say no, because, you know, she just knows that's the way I am. Like, I think I'm similar to my father in that way, that I like to be a pioneer. My brother thought I was totally crazy. He studied film at NYU and said, I don't know what I'm doing. What are you doing? My sister and my wife thought I was nuts. You know, this was a project that took a long time, a lot of really networking. But my vision was that, you know, the world needed something like this. I wanted my son and my daughter to feel proud that they're Asian. I wanted also the rest of the world to understand Asian people from a different perspective. I felt like every narrative that you saw from another person looking at Asian people, that it always looked the same to me on film or in media. And I wanted to show another layer. And that's what I hope to do. It was kind of like a dream that became a passion, and that passion turned into an obligation, I feel, for a lot of Asian people that look up to me now. And it's been great. Very grateful that HBO gave me the opportunity.
Thank you. Can you kind of take us back a little bit to when the idea first became like ruminating in your head, and like how long ago was that, and how did it develop?
So, you know, when I was in my 20s, that's when The Real World came out on MTV and a lot of different reality shows. And my American, my white friends, I guess, they would always say, man, Washington, you're interesting. You know, you should be on this show or that show or this show. And I was like, you're crazy. I don't need to be on the show. I'm too rich. Like, it doesn't matter. And then when I got into my 30s, more unscripted reality shows were coming out. And I saw some successful ones and some unsuccessful ones. And at the time, while I was building my own business, Bolt Street Energy Advisors, I was spending a lot of money on marketing. So social media marketing, you know, marketing and advertisement and branding just cost so much money. I thought to myself after the third year, I said, how am I gonna grow my business? But I don't have the money right now for marketing. So I said, okay, well, you know what? Why don't I try to go on some reality show, and then people will know me. Once they know me, they'll find out like that I sell energy, and that's gonna be a great idea. And then I told myself, I said, well, how can I do that though? I don't really know many people in Hollywood. I'm from Houston, Texas. So naturally I manifested to myself that, you know, I was this Asian cowboy that was interesting. And I would fly into Los Angeles on my private jet. And, you know, I would be myself, and I would go to where all the celebrities go. So you always look on the tabloids and magazines, everybody eats at Wolfgang Puck's restaurant, Spago. So I said, okay, I'll pick some busy weekend. I'll just fly there by myself in my cowboy boots, in my cowboy hat, and just sit at the bar by myself and eat lunch. And I know some agent sooner or later is gonna come up to me and ask me, what's your name? Who are you? And so that's exactly what happened, because I'm a sales guy. And I said, well, you know, my name is Washington. My father's a banker. And, you know, everybody's always looking for money. And in 2017, you know, everybody's like, hey, you got to go to Asia to raise money. They got so much money. So I kind of used that story for myself. And I said, you know, well, if you have a project and you want me to finance it, I can talk to our bank and we can see if we can make things happen. So once the agents found out that there was a banker in town that might be able to finance some of their projects, I got to look at a lot of different projects. However, after about a year and a half, Crazy Rich Asians came out. I know my sister read the book, but it didn't come out. The movie didn't come out till August of 2018. When the movie came out and became successful, that's when I called a friend of mine who is an actor, Anthony Anderson. I called him, I said, hey man, I said, Hollywood needs you right now. I said, I need you to help me have my own reality show. I go, do you think that can happen? And so Anthony Anderson said, he goes, man, ho, man, you're a crazy ho. That's why I love you. He's like, let me tell you something, Wash. It's a lot easier for you to go buy a lottery ticket right now and win the lotto than for you to go and create your own reality show in Hollywood, okay? But he goes, if you can do it, it's probably gonna be really great. If you do it, you can open up doors for other Asians that wanna be in mainstream, and I'll help you do it. And I said, you said there's an easier chance for me to win the lottery? He goes, yeah. He goes, this is not gonna happen, but I'll teach you how to do it. And I said, okay, well, teach me. And I'm the kind of person that's very like my father. You know, when he told people he was gonna open a bank, they're like, you're crazy. I said, okay. So I put my foot forward. I used LinkedIn and added people from different production companies and try to learn the business, made some relationships, and the success of that movie propelled my plan, because at the time I was the only Asian person that developed the plan that was ready to go. And so once the movie hit, all the production companies called me and they had already met me, things were already moving along. I told my family about it. I said, hey, you're not gonna have to be on the show, but I just need you to sign these papers. So they signed some holding agreements for the rights to their story. And we started working on the project. But I didn't know that I still had like a 1 in a million chance to get the show. But as they got to know our family, they felt like we shouldn't finance the project, that we should be in front of the camera. They said, you know, we interviewed 62 Asian families around the world. Some of them were too rich. Some of them were trying to be someone they are not. Some of them weren't open enough. And a lot of the stereotypes you would see about Asian people. But what they said about our family was that we were relatable. And I said, you know, you guys are crazy. I'm not doing this. And they said, well, Washington, you know, a lot of Asian people around the world go to school to study acting, to, you know, make movies, to get in this industry, and they just haven't had the luck. And we're asking you right now, we're HBO, we need you to do this so that you can open up the doors for other Asians. And we know your family, you know, your father's legacy was helping the Vietnamese community learn how to finance their business. And you said you always want to have your own legacy. And we feel like we can build your legacy over 5 years. And that's when I agreed to do the deal with HBO. It's because this is a legacy deal for them and for us. For them, it's a partnership with, you know, a group of Asians that they've never done. They've never done any projects. And they were comfortable that with the way my family worked. And for us, it took a lot of trust. It was really hard because, you know, when you put your stuff out there and you have so much to lose, it takes not just guts, but a lot of love for my family to help me and support. But I felt like I could really inspire a lot of people to be better. But most of all, I can inspire myself and my family and my kids, for all of us to be better. And that's how the project happened. I just got a little bit of luck here and there, some vision, and a lot of hard work, a lot of love and support from my family, and a lot of love and support from HBO and the production people behind the staff. They understood my vision. So again, communication is key when, you know, you go into a whole new industry. And I feel like my father putting me into that private school taught me how to communicate and make it happen. So
yeah, thank you for sharing that background story. I'm just also wondering how authentic do you think the documentary or the reality show portrayed you and your family?
I would say that it's as authentic as it could be. What you understand as an untrained actor is that, you know, when there's five cameras on you at all times from different angles, and, you know, it's a network like HBO that uses top of the line equipment that can hear different decibels in your voice, is that you have no choice but to be authentic. Now, that's only for the cameras, but since we as a family sat down before we filmed and told each other that, look, for us to inspire and to help other Asians understand us and for other races to understand Asian people, we're gonna have to be authentic. And when we finish a project, at the end of it, we had to remind each other that, look, we're always gonna love each other and be there for each other. But for that moment of filming, we've got to be as real as possible for it to work. And so it was pretty real. And I would say that, you know, something interesting is that, you know, that someone hasn't asked me that I want to say is that if the cameras weren't there, would the same things have happened in our lives? You know, like would Judy really, if the cameras weren't there and I wasn't pushing her to do that at that moment, would we really sit down at dinner and she open up and announce and say, look, Dad, I'm not happy with what's going on? Or if the cameras weren't there, would me and my wife really have that many issues to talk about, right? Because in our culture, in the Asian culture, a lot of times we sweep things under the rug. Especially when you have money, it's like, okay, let's talk about, you know, talk about other people or something else or what's going, you know, but it's never like, look, we have something to talk about. And so, you know, for me, I think being on camera made my family have to open up, and now we're closer than we've ever been. These are things that every family, I think, can relate to. The acceptance of, you know, your parents, whether you're Asian, white, Black, or Hispanic, we understand that. Last year was such a tough year for everybody going through the pandemic. Whether you're a business owner or you're working for a company, I feel like we all understand each other. There's a lot of crazy things going on last year, but at the end of the day, you know, as long as you're healthy, then I think you're able to improve and get better. And you know, we should be grateful.
Yeah, thank you. And I was also reading about that the release date of the series initially was earlier on in the year, and then it got pushed back due to the pandemic as well. Was that also part of your decision?
You know, at that time when the pandemic happened, we couldn't do our editing and our pickups, and a lot of logistical things had to change. And actually, I was afraid that, you know, the project might have to be wrapped up. So, you know, fortunately, we were working with a great network. And, you know, after doing our due diligence and study, we felt like it was the wrong time to come out with the show until the world had settled down a little bit. And, you know, we also, I see your sign behind you, Humanities. Something I learned during the show was how much work networks do to find, to know when to release any show or movie. And due to the fact that our show was all Asian cast, they don't have any comparables to see when the right time to open was. And there was a lot going on in the world as well with Black Lives Matter and George Floyd in Houston, Texas. And our family, we decided we wanted to give, not take the attention away from that. And so we wanted to, you know, delay it if possible, and HBO was flexible. They also provided us more funding to do more editing to make sure that we weren't going to be tone deaf to the current situation. And, you know, we're happy that it came out when it did.
Thank you for sharing that part of the story. And I guess since we are touching on the Black Lives Matter and the death of George Floyd, if you wouldn't mind answering a few questions that in our racial justice and civic engagement collection, can I ask you, what is your relationship with the Black Lives Matter movement?
My relationship? You know, I've had Black friends all my life. And like I said, I grew up, you know, I grew up in an area where predominantly Black people. And, you know, at all my life, you know, having really close friends that are Black, playing sports with Black people, I felt like, you know, it's been tough for them. In America, you know, growing up and seeing my parents own businesses in the Black neighborhoods as well, I've seen unfair treatment. I've seen, you know, systems and governmental systems to assist, but also sometimes I feel like it's very marginal. You know, I'll never understand what it's like to be Black, but whether you're, you know, Black, Asian, white, or human, I feel like we need to treat each other the same and respect each other the same. And at the end of the day, we're all trying to do the same thing, which is, you know, do the right thing and take care of our family. And, you know, I love all my Black brothers and sisters, and, you know, they've done a lot. My family would not be where we are without the Black people. And, you know, there's still a lot going on in this world. I know it's gonna take a lot of time to change, but, you know, my daughter, her name is Lincoln. I named her after Abraham Lincoln, who, you know, freed the slaves for a reason, because he was a great leader. And besides BLM, I feel like, you know, for my daughter, I wanted her to be a leader for gender discrimination and inequalities. I've seen many qualified female candidates in different companies I've invested in, not, you know, get the same treatment, get the same pay, get the same respect. And so once I had a daughter, I understood it more. Once I had my own company, I understood it more. But I feel like, you know, I'm so proud of my show because I empowered my wife and my sister to be able to lead and to be strong. And that's where the modern world is. And I'm so proud that a lot of female fans have reached out to me and said, hey, you know, you've inspired my husband to be better. you've really helped us, you know, see that, you know, our issues are things that we can fix. And I'm very, very proud of that.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And what are some of your thoughts following the most recent election results? And we'll also be having our first South Asian American and an African American MP, women of color, like women in the House, in the White House.
Well, you know, I think the world kind of has changed a lot. I think the internet has changed the world. And, you know, America is the land of opportunity, the land of free speech. And, you know, to see a female vice president that's not Caucasian, to me, it just proves that. And I know it's, I think it's difficult for a lot of people that have lived here for centuries to see that, but it's, you know, to see that that's possible, I think it should inspire a lot of, you know, females or males or whoever it is that anything's possible. I'm definitely proud to be in a country where that's possible. And I think it's just taking some time for a lot of people to get used to it.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And next, I guess the next few questions will just address on your Asian American identity, and a little bit of the kind of intergenerational differences of Asian Americans. The first one will be, what is the first experience that you felt being a minority different from the rest of the people around you?
The first time that, you know, it was a very profound experience. It was my senior year in high school. And, you know, I never had any problems with the school. You know, I brought a state championship tennis, doubles tennis championship to the school. And there was some other Asian student that had issues with the school, and they expelled him. And because they said I'm associated with him, they expelled me. That was my senior year in high school. And I had, you know, early decision to schools in Boston at the time. It was tough for me because, you know, I was a top, you know, top student there. I'd been there for almost 7 years. It was tough for my parents because, you know, we didn't know what to do. And there were a lot of other kids. Parents made a lot of big charitable contributions. They grew up in the society, in the school, did a lot of crazy things, but never got in any trouble. So, you know, I always, you know, I remember my dad, he used to always, you know, since the age of 3, he would drive me around every weekend at school or in the neighborhood and teach me business. And he always told me, he said, hey, you know, just never forget the color of your skin. He goes, America's a great country, but they're always going to teach you, it's not what you know, it's who you know. But he said, don't believe that. It's what you know, it's who you know, and it's who needs you. And because we're Asian, you got to be double as good, or you got to work twice as hard to get to where the Americans are. And so over the course of my life, you know, I've seen things where, you know, sometimes we pay a heavier price for things than some of my other friends. And my friends will tell me the truth is that, you know, I think I hope that, you know, it gets better when my kids grow up, but, you know, that there's always that, I can't fully say that, you know, that doesn't concern me, but that was my first time to know that, you know, that, you know, things were gonna be different.
Wow, it's amazing to hear your father's not only a visionary businessman, but a very, very visionary and wise person. That's very inspiring. And just to clarify, so when that happened, you were the only other Asian student in the school. That's why you got also expelled.
Yeah, there was one other Asian student, and he got in a fight. And so, you know, I wasn't even there. I was out of town, and, you know, I was guilty by association, but this time I felt like it was guilty by the color of your skin, you know? So.
That's disheartening.
It was, you know, I mean, we had our 20-year reunion last year, and they still invite me, and all the kids are like, man, Washington, they're like, man, that was so, they still tell me, like, my friends, they're like, that was so wrong what they did. You know, we have Bible school every day, and they teach, you know, a lot of things and teach us not to be hypocritical. And the friends that I've made over there, I think, you know, because of that incident, they have expressed to me that they wouldn't send their kids there for school. So, you know, it's it was tough. I remember at the time, the law was that if you had been expelled, you had to wait 1 year to go back to school. So my mom and I were driving around all over town, you know, and we didn't understand it, but, you know, we're like, hey, we're renting an apartment here, so you go to school here. But it was like, no, you have to wait a year. So luckily, my father, through some political connections, got to meet the dean of Lutheran North, and they were happy to have me. And, you know, SMU, I had to explain to them what happened, and I still got a scholarship because I was a top student and a good athlete. And but it was not easy though.
And I guess given the hardship, were there any point in your upbringing that you would reject and later reconcile with your identity?
Can you please repeat that?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I meant, like, given the hardship, was there any point in your childhood or upbringing that you would reject your Asian American identity but later reconcile with it?
No, I was always, you know, I never rejected my identity. You know, it was a part of me. But also, one thing that makes it different for me was my name's Washington. And I'm Asian. So everybody knew I was Binh Ho's son because they knew Binh Ho named his kids after presidents. And so that I couldn't really hide, even if I wanted to. I tried a few times, but I was just, you know, I used to go to my dad and say, Dad, why did you name me Washington? I'm like, I'm so tired of being known. Like, I don't need this right now. And my dad's like, that's why. He goes, because if you do something great, people will remember you. And if you don't do something great, then they'll be like, why is his name Washington? So, you know, I always will learn from my father to, you know, be proud that I'm Asian. But one thing that he was really good at was how to turn that into, you know, a weapon in your arsenal to give you a distinct, you know, advantage. You know, he always said, Washington, you know, you get to learn from two cultures. You know, a lot of people don't. When you walk into a room, immediately you're going to be different. And so you can use that to your advantage. And so watching him do that taught me a lot of different ways to do that as well. And I think it's helped me. I've been proud of that.
Yeah, that was amazing. And also, I'm wondering, have you ever grew up with different opinions with your parents? For example, and the intergenerational gaps.
Yeah, the generational gap, definitely, you know, we have different opinions. You know, my parents came in a different time, but fortunately my father, who reads a lot every day, always up to date on current events, he's an old school guy, but he's very open-minded. My mother, she's not as open-minded, but she respects, you know, my father. But, you know, she's like any mother, I would say, not always satisfied, but, you know, I think she's learned that her kids are going to be the way they are. You know, Reagan, my younger brother, is never afraid to voice his opinion in our family. And then my sister, she loves to please my parents, but especially my father. But as we've gotten older, we've been able to voice our opinions more. But when we were younger, I would say that that wasn't really a good thing to do.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And also, I guess in your next generation, for your son and daughter, what are your ways to tackle on the differences they might have when they grow up?
You know, Leslie, my wife, my lovely wife, is a strict disciplinarian. And so, you know, I leave a lot of the brain work to her. I'm very friendly with my kids. I think I get it from my dad, but, you know, they're going to change and they're going to be different. And, you know, I've spoken to friends, and, you know, I think nothing can prepare me for that. But, you know, if my son comes home with, you know, purple hair and says it's because I did it on the TV show, then it's all my fault, you know, and I'm just gonna have to accept it. But I think that's something that, you know, is very not Asian, is to, you know, to allow your child to pursue their passion instead of, I think also my generation, we're a lot more lucky where it's not like all about survival. So I think it's gonna be easier for me to say, hey son, if you wanna be an actor, go to Hollywood. You wanna do this, you know, go try it out. But when I told my dad I wanted to go to USC and film school after college, and my mom, they didn't even go with me to the tour of the school and the interview. I had to go fly up there by myself. She was like, you know, you want to go and be an actor in Hollywood? That's up to you. Like, I'm not going. And it hurt me at the time, actually. But it was one of the things that I never forgot, is that, you know, if I was going to tell my kids to always search for your passion, but I never tried to go to Hollywood, then I could never tell them that. So that was one of the reasons I did House of Ho, so that I could tell my kids, no matter what age you are, you can always find something you love to do. And the reason mom and dad work so hard is so that you can find what you love. And I would rather my kids make less money and do something they love and makes them happy than to be super successful in a field that they weren't happy in and wonder all their life if they should have tried something else. And so, you know, that, I don't know, you know, why, you know, this all happened to me, but when I try to find purpose and reason, it's that, you know, I always enjoyed making the people around me better. I always enjoyed being the first guy to, you know, run into the wall if I had to, but I always celebrated my Asian culture and heritage. You know, I was the president of the Vietnamese Student Association at SMU. I was the president of my Spanish club at Second Baptist. I was the leader of our tennis team. But I always enjoyed being the person to be a pioneer. And I think my father naming me Washington had a lot to do with that. Because when you manifest your vision and you live in your vision and you live in and you feel it and it goes through your body, like the Asian culture says, the positive energy will radiate the positive energy around you. And, you know, at the end of the day, we're all human beings and we all, you know, have to help each other.
Yeah, that's absolutely true and so amazingly said. And next, I'm wondering, can you share with us how you met your wife, Leslie? I guess we heard a lot of her side of the story from the TV. Maybe if you wouldn't mind sharing from your angle.
Sure. I this 2013, and, you know, I'm out networking for business, and I meet I was going out to meet a girl from Oklahoma, but it wasn't my wife, it was her best friend. But she happened to have my wife with her, and I was with Reagan. And, you know, I met her briefly, but a month later, had to go to Las Vegas for my boss's wedding. This was 2013, and I needed a date for his wedding. And I had never had, you know, a serious Asian girlfriend. You know, I date a lot of, different girls. I never had an Asian girlfriend. And so I called my brother, Reagan, and I asked him, I said, do you know any, like, normal girls in Las Vegas right now? Like, and he's like, what do you mean normal? I said, someone that, you know, would look good with me. I got to go to my boss's wedding. I need a promotion and it can't be some trashy girl. And he said, oh, well, Leslie's up there. And I said, Leslie, who's Leslie? And he's like, Leslie, the girl you met a month ago, we took her. I said, well, what does she look like? So he sent me a photo on Facebook and I was like, oh, okay, she's cute. I mean, you think she remembers me? And he's like, I don't think she's going to talk to you, but, like, you can try. And I said, okay. He goes, she's there for her birthday. So I sent her a message. Hey, Leslie, it's Washington. Happy birthday. Just if you want to hang out in Las Vegas, let me know. And so she replied, like, no, I'm with my girlfriends, like, you know, have fun. The next day I sent another message. Hey, Leslie. Hey, I'm going to go eat with my friends. If you want to hang out, let me know. The wedding was a day later. Finally, she replied and said, hey, let's hang out. So she couldn't get into a club. It was Encore Hotel. There's a big DJ, two lines around the block. I had the best table in the middle. So her and her girlfriends, it took them like, they waited in line for like 2-3 hours. She finally called me like, hey, I want to go to this party. Like, do you know about it? I go, yeah, I got a table. I can get you in right away. And she's like, really? I was like, yeah, I'll come get you. So I came and got her. We met, we hung out, and she was my date to the wedding. And I remember the cab driver, she was like, y'all are so cute. It's going to be so cute one day when y'all, when, you know, y'all are going to be, y'all are such a beautiful couple. And my boss and all the energy executives were like, man, Wash, how did you do that? Like, who is this? I go, oh, you know, I'm this is what I do, guys. Like, don't worry about it. And so I told her like, hey, just pretend you're my girlfriend. Like, don't worry, I'm gonna take you and your friends to dinner, but just make me look good so I can get a promotion. And she thought I was crazy. And so, you know, 6 months later, you know, I needed a date for New Year's Eve. And, you know, she was living in Dallas. She lived in the same apartment complex I first lived in when I went to SMU. She lived on Washington Street. Her first job in Houston was the CVS on Washington. So she thought it was a sign. And so she, you know, she moved to Houston and the rest is history.
Wow, that was like one of the most adorable stories about, yeah, how like the love stories of Asian Americans. I'm wondering, you know, yeah, go ahead, sorry.
I always tell people, and something my dad always taught me is this. He said, you know, in business or in life, a lot of people, they're not successful because they cannot see, feel, and touch momentum and opportunity or luck coming their way. So if you don't grab it right away and it's that great, someone else will take it. So when I saw my wife, I had to kidnap her right away. Because if it's such a great person and girl, you don't grab it. Some other guy's just waiting and, you know, they're gonna take her. So, you know, applying a little bit about, you know, opportunity. When I met my wife, I called my mom and I said, Mom, I just found my wife. But I was calling from Las Vegas and my mom's an Asian mom. So she's like, oh my God, son, please, I don't need more crazy girls in my life. Like, don't. I go, Mom, she says she's a pharmacist. I think she has a real job, okay? My mom goes, how do you know? She's in Las Vegas. Like, what is she doing in Las Vegas? I go, Mom, I'm like, Mom, trust me, she's Vietnamese. And my mom's like, is she Catholic or is she, what is she? You know, and I'm like, I don't know. I'm not gonna ask her. My mom didn't believe me. But once I brought her home, you know, we weren't dating. I just introduced and my mom goes, just like you see in the show, she's like, you're gonna marry this girl. And I'm like, of course, if you watch the show, you'll see what happens, but it's pretty authentic. And yeah, my mother-in-law, she went to go visit her for Thanksgiving every year. So we went to see her and I said, hey, Mom, what do you think? And she was like, I don't like this. Is that true what you said about, you know, like your mom telling you to marry my daughter? And I was like, no, it's all acting.
I hope she didn't see this interview.
She'll see it. But, you know, my mother-in-law loves me now. She understands me better. So I think it's, that was one of the pluses actually of doing the show is, you know, a lot of people that are close to me but don't really understand me got to see another side of me. And it helped our relationship, actually.
Yeah. And I'm also curious for your son and daughter in the future when they're bringing home like spouses, would you kind of give them the freedom to choose their own spouse? Or would the kind of the Asian mom also be, or the Asian parent, having like that Catholic and kind of your own race or ethnicity type of expectation be part of it?
You know, the divorce rate in America is really high. And, you know, you basically have a 50% chance basically of picking the right person. And, you know, for my parents, you know, my dad was always very cool, calm, and collected. He only, you know, gives that advice when asked, but, you know, I think, you know, if my kids wanted to marry somebody, I mean, I would hope that they would ask for my opinion after all I've been through now. But, you know, we're in America, and, you know, if my son's as crazy as me, he might just drive to the courthouse and get married on paper. I don't know. But I think, you know, to be honest, my wife, Leslie, I think she's going to be on top of that. I think it's going to be hard for them to do anything without mom, like, giving her opinion. But for me, you know, I believe that all people are good in different ways. I believe that, you know, just because you make a mistake doesn't mean you can't turn around and change and turn it into a positive. And I always believe in people. So for me, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, who they choose. I just hope that the person they choose is the right person.
Yeah, absolutely. I guess as we are approaching the end of our interview, we'd like to ask if you have anything else you would like to share, and if you have some messages to leave for the archive.
Sure. I would just like to say, you know, thank you so much, you know, for the Child Center for Asian Studies and Rice University, which is a great university, which I attended for 2 summers in high school in the high school academic program. Thank you so much for having me and for loving and supporting my family and my vision and being open-minded to understanding, you know, Washington Ho, who I know is not a normal Asian person at all. And I look forward to doing more projects together. And, you know, for all the students and people who get to watch this, I just want you to know that you should never be afraid to be yourself. And that's the most important thing in life, is to be authentic, be true to yourself. And that's the best way to inspire others.
Well, thank you so much. And I'm thrilled we have that connection at Rice University too. And I would also like to invite you to do a time capsule with us to leave a message for your future generations, like your son, your daughter, and your future grandchildren and so on. Like, what would you like to say to them when they watch this interview?
Like to say, love you guys, and this is a legacy project, and never be afraid to be proud of your heritage, and remember to always do the right thing. And the right thing is not always the most profitable thing, but it's always going to be the best thing.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ho.
You're welcome.